I work for Ben & Jerry's as market researcher, amongst other brands as well. But for Ben & Jerry's, my briefing from my marketing team was really to go on to an experiment, a journey, and really learn about how it is to interact with your fans, to feel their heartbeat on a daily level and really see and have a nice connection with them, but also to really fuel their activation plans, to build their brands stronger in the markets. And we're here in the UK, where Ben & Jerry has already got quite some presence and quite some heritage. In the Benelux, especially in Belgium, it's still one of the newer brands. So we really want to know, how can we build on to more fans? We want their feedback. We wanted to know what they thought of our ideas, our opinions, our plans. But also, what we also wanted to offer was the room to exchange ideas and to give us that unsolicited feedback that was mentioned before. So what we set up was, we wanted kind of like a tool for 24/7 connection, to observe the conversations that were going on, and also allow marketeers to participate with them. And in order to facilitate that, we come up with the Insight team on on research communities, and let Tom be our guide to take you through the process how we came up with this.
We already had two speeches on research communities today, and you can say, do we really need a third speech on research communities? Because the methodology itself, it's not that new, knowing that Community Space already did their first one in 2000. But like Diane said, over the past years, we as an industry, we suffered quite a lot with doing it the right way, with engaging in the right way with those people, with getting the maximum out of our research participants, and especially with bringing the insights into the company. We spent it over the last couple of years a lot of time on doing research on how to conduct research communities. And I want to share some insights that we gathered from that together with you. And it will show you how we also dealt with the Ben & Jerry's project. A first question a lot of people ask themselves is, how many people do you need in the research community? And that was one of the first questions that we tackled together with our partner in this, the University of Maastricht in the Netherlands. And we wanted to come up with some kind of formula, just like you have in quantitative research. How many people do I need? Not to have a scientific sample, but in this case, to have a group of people that will deliver you great insights, a dynamic research community. We came up with a formula with three ingredients. The first one is the fact that people participate in waves. People, you cannot expect that people will participate every single day and that they will answer to every single question. That's just an illusion. So you have to take that into account, that participation rates will shift over time because people have busier and less busier periods also in their personal life. The second thing we took into account is that, based on our experience, we first of all saw that you need at least a third a third of a page long to, in the end, do a decent qualitative analysis. Another thing we found through research is that after those 30 comments, you find more of the same kind of things. The number of arguments that are new are like, it's saturating, it's some kind of saturation effect. So in that sense, it would also be, let's say, not that effective to generate 100 or even 150 comments, because after 30, after 40, you don't learn anything new anymore. And last but not least, we also took a look at what's the ideal time frame to do a research community. We saw that for a lot of our clients, and I think Martijn will come back to that later on, it's very time intensive to have a community always on. So we rather work with communities that are open and that close down again. And if we do a strategic project like we did for Ben & Jerry's, we work with a time frame of 3 months. So taking, let's say, those three parameters into account, the participation rate, the fact that we need about 30 conversations at least, and also that is the most effective number to have a good qualitative analysis, and the fact that in this case we worked with for 3 months, we came to 150 people as, let's say, the optimum number of people in our community. And what was nice is that 150, it's also the number of Dunbar. I don't know who in the room knows Dunbar, but Dunbar is a scientist who did research among primates, among apes, to find out with how many other apes can an ape have social contacts. And he found out that that number was 80. And of course, the next question he asked himself was, and how would that be with human beings? And instead of just conducting the research again, he took the brain size of a monkey, of an ape, and of a human being, and made some extrapolations, which he came up with that number of 150. So in a way, we proved in a community, in a research community, that Dunbar was right with his 150 people. And we also see that 150 people as the maximum number of people we want in our communities. Why? Because we see that if we go above those 150, it's rather difficult for the moderator to still have a good relationship with each and single participant. So we really believe that every single participant can deliver you a golden insight. And that's why we want to have, like in just normal qualitative, offline qualitative research, a very strong relationship with all the participants. And that becomes very difficult when you go above the 150 number.